We're going to go and reread again Matthew 19, just so we can finish this off this morning. The first 12 verses. If you are able this morning, I would encourage you to stand as we reread this passage of Scripture. And we're doing good to encourage people to come to church. We're talking about marriage, divorce, remarriage this week. And then next week, we're going to talk about money. So there you go. Should be real fun. Well, it's a rich young ruler who's told what? To go and sell all that he had. So we're expecting a packed house for Denny next week. But seriously, we're just walking through the Bible. And as you walk through the Bible, you got to just teach, preach what God's word says. So chapter 19 says, "Now when Jesus had finished these sayings, he went away from Galilee and entered the region of Judea beyond the Jordan. And large crowds followed him, and he healed them there." Excuse me. "And Pharisees came up to him and tested him by asking, 'Is it lawful to divorce one's wife for any cause?' He answered, 'Have you not read that he who created them from the beginning made them male and female? And said, Therefore a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let not man separate.' They said to him, 'Why then did Moses command one to give a certificate of divorce and to send her away?' He said to them, 'Because of your hardness of heart, Moses allowed you to divorce your wives, but from the beginning it was not so. And I say to you that whoever divorces his wife except for sexual immorality and marries another commits adultery.' The disciple said to him, 'If such is the case of a man with his wife, it is better not to marry.' But he said to them, 'Not everyone can receive this saying, but only those to whom it is given. There are eunuchs who have been so far from birth, and there are eunuchs who have been made eunuchs by men, and there are eunuchs who have made themselves eunuchs for the sake of the kingdom of heaven. Let the one who is able to receive this receive it.'" Father, we pray this morning that, God, you will just speak by your Spirit through your word, that any words that I share will be hidden through by your Spirit, Father, and they will be the truths of your Scripture. Father, we love you, praise you. Give us ears to hear and our hearts to be open this morning. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. So we started last week. We kind of started with walking through this passage, and we're going to kind of pick up a little bit, but I want to recap a few things. One, the Pharisees are, as they so often do, they're trying to trip up Jesus. They're trying to test him. They're trying to get him to make a statement that then they can come against him with. And so they are referring particularly to Deuteronomy 24, where Moses had allowed, not commanded, but had allowed a certificate of divorce. But in that case, and we need to understand this because a lot of Scripture, we don't realize the full context, was referring to if a man who had gone and had made a contract, which was a covenant, with the father of his future bride, and that covenant would have been one in which that father was committing his daughter and even saying that his daughter was going to be a virgin, that on the wedding night, if it was discovered she was not, that he would have a legal way to get out of that marriage. So you have to understand all of Scripture. We so often will just take parts of it out. And that's what they are trying to use to trip him. But we talked about the fact that marriage is a picture of the covenant of God that God has with his people, and that God is the one who created marriage. He is the one who gave us marriage. It is his good idea. Now, we know, traditionally speaking, there's basically four different views on the subject of divorce and remarriage. And I'm just going to list these, and if you weren't here last week, you can go back too. But number one, and that's not like number one, like this is the top. These are just listed not in a particular order. But one view is that Christians must never divorce and remarry. Now, understand that even with that saying, there are obvious situations that someone may have to get away from a person, whether it be through an abusive situation, that they need to get away. But just say that Christians must never divorce and remarry. That's one position. Another position is that divorce is permissible in cases of adultery and desertion, but not given permission to remarry. Third position is that divorce is permissible for adultery and desertion, and then remarriage is permissible for the innocent party. And the fourth is that divorce is permissible for adultery, desertion, and in other special circumstances, and remarriage is permissible for the innocent and those who repent. Now, we looked at a number of topics. I'm just going to name them so we don't have time to go through them all. But one is that marriage is God's design and it is for good. God's design for marriage is good. We went back to the garden and walked through God's original intent. It is God himself who brought Eve. He gave away the first bride. He created Eve out of Adam. He presented to Adam his bride. Secondly, that we need to invest in our marriage. And that means, by the way, young people, it starts now. It doesn't start when you all of a sudden are in a position that you may be thinking about marriage. It starts right now. It's learning God's standard for marriage. It's starting now to understand what you should look for in a future husband or wife. It starts early on. Parents, that means also we are to demonstrate, we are to teach, we are to talk about that. And hopefully, even though we're sinners, if you are married, you are working to model what hopefully your son or daughter would one day want to see in a marriage. Again, that does not mean that we are not going to blow it many times, but forgiveness is a powerful tool. Repentance is something that they need to see from their parents when we do fall short. And guess what? We will. And guess what? We will often fail. We will fall short. We will say things we shouldn't say. We will do things we should not do. And then we need to also make sure in that context that we are showing our children what genuine repentance looks like so they understand no marriage is perfect. Amen? Can I get a witness? No marriage is perfect. It's not going to be perfect as long as you're in it anyway. Amen? And that's all of us, right? It's just not going to happen. We're sinners. We said last week, when you get married and you have another person that comes in and you marry, that's two sinners. When you have that first little sinner, that's another sinner in the house and another sinner. And before you know, it's just a household full of sinners. And a household full of sinners, a lot can happen. But you need to invest. It is the greatest investment you can make. Amen? It just simply is. It has the highest return. If you want to make an investment that will return and return and return, it is in your marriage because that affects ultimately your children, if you have children, and then your children's children and children's children. And that is called a legacy. And legacy is something that we want to see godly legacies raised up by men and women, husband and wives, who are committed to Christ. It is very important. You know, you see it time and time again, okay? And if you've experienced this, our hearts do go out to you. But how often do we see it just takes one generation and a godly couple, all of a sudden, they have kids that are not following the Lord. And maybe they don't even know the Lord. It doesn't take a lot, right? It doesn't. It can be one generation. Or you have children and then their children are no longer walking with the Lord. They're doing everything else in the world. And anything that you put, listen, parents have a really bad, bad habit of thinking, well, if I'm doing something with my kid on Sunday morning, but no, you're still putting whatever that is ahead of the Lord. To not be part of the local body regularly is called idolatry, that you're placing other things ahead of God himself. If you're with your kids, it just means you're setting an even worse example because you're actually condoning the behavior, okay? We need to understand God is worth it, and we will give an account. Every single Christian is going to stand before King Jesus and answer for what we did with all he gave us. And you know, one of the first things he gives us is our family. We're accountable. We talked about this week, right? Your kid's 30 years old and they're making bad choices. I mean, I know that's on them. But as long as your children are under your care, men, you and I are accountable. We will answer to a holy, righteous God for what we did and how we led them. Amen? That's amen, because we are accountable and we need to invest in our marriage. We need to invest in our family. And then we talked about the fact that we need to be slow when it comes to areas of divorce. Hear me clearly here. There are obviously cases within families that there is a bad situation that's occurring. It does not mean that that person should not get away, for certainly for a time, and it might be longer, but they need that there is a time, but there is abuse, if there's situations of that magnitude, that does. But my point is that Bible is clear in terms of slowly move towards it, because we so quickly want to use the Bible as a justification for the reason why we can be, and And that's not God's standard. So we need to always move slow. We talked about some of the misnomers, the myths. The fact is that a Christian couple, a Christian husband and wife who were fully committed to Christ, who were growing in Christ, who were working together. I showed you, hopefully, if you didn't see, I used my hands, but if you took a salt and pepper shaker and you got the ketchup bottle, and as a husband and wife, if you form a triangle, as you are growing closer together, closer to Christ, you will grow closer together. So that couple who is growing in Christ has like a less than 10% chance of being divorced. The point is, one would have to not be growing or not committed to Christ, which is why it's so important that young people, you should date Christians. There is no, you know, missionary dating where I'm just going to date this guy, I'm going to date this girl, and they're going to come to the Lord. That's contrary to God's word. That's being unequally yoked. Unequally yoked is not just marriage. It is you should not be dating. You are contrary to God when you do that, and it often does not work out. So we need to be very slow when it comes to areas of divorce. Now, we talked a little bit. I'm going to walk through this kind of very specifically, which is why I needed 2 weeks to do this. But when we talked about being slow to divorce, let's go back to the birth of Christ. In Matthew 1, it says that now the birth of Christ took place this way when his mother Mary had been betrothed. Okay, she was in a legally binding agreement with Joseph. There was a contract. There was a covenant that had been presented to Mary's dad. We don't hear about Mary's parents, but the reality is most likely Joseph would have gone to Mary's father and would have presented to her a contract that would have been a covenant that would have been signed. Remember, they are in Nazareth. This is a little small village, not a massive metropolis area. Very good odds. We don't know. I'm not trying to be extra biblical, but the odds are they probably knew who each other were. We don't know a lot, obviously, or hardly any about their prior histories, but we can imagine just being in a small community. They probably knew somewhat of each other. Almost all marriages were arranged so that father of Joseph probably knew Mary's family and probably had worked almost maybe even to some extent behind the scenes and tried to encourage. So fathers are always looking out for their children. So came together and they were betrothed, which means they were now in a legally binding agreement. They had not been married, but you have to understand, marriage did not take place. Marriage was not official until the consummation. Okay, so they're betrothed. And it says, so Mary had been betrothed to Jesus, and before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. Okay? So, and we'll get into this more in depth in a little bit. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. So even in that agreement, even in that situation, right? In Joseph's mind, Mary's getting ready to have a baby. She's pregnant, and it's not Joseph's baby. So this betrothal period was a time typically could last as much as a year, a betrothal period. So if you've been engaged, you kind of have some idea, but your engagement's not legally binding. This was a legally binding agreement, and it was a time to kind of get yourself together, somewhat organized. We'll get into very specifics of what the groom-to-be would be doing during that time. It was a very specific act, and there was this time. But Joseph saying this, we need to understand this. We're not going to read it, but even Jesus himself, when you read the gospel accounts in Mark and Luke, he in those accounts does not give the actual, what we call the exception clause. So we need to be very slow. And then the next part is to also, we need to pursue remarriage. We do not need to pursue remarriage quickly. And again, let's look through the Bible. 1 Corinthians 7. And we'll try to finish this up here shortly so I can share this last part. It says, 1 Corinthians 7, verse 12, to the rest I say, I, not the Lord, that if any brother has a wife who is an unbeliever, and she consents to live with him, he should not divorce her. If any woman has a husband who is an unbeliever, and he consents to live with her, she should not divorce him. For the unbelieving husband is made holy because of his wife, and the unbelieving wife is made holy because of her husband. Otherwise, your children would be unclean, but as it is, they are holy. But if the unbelieving partner separates, let it be so. In such cases, the brother or sister is not enslaved. God has called you to peace. But for how do you know, wife, whether you will save your husband, or how do you know, husband, whether you will save your wife? So the point is, slow to divorce, slow to remarriage. You don't know what God is going to do. But obviously, because we are sinners, and understand, that's where this ultimately comes from, right? Instead of trying to find within the Bible justifications to do things, we have to understand, we do things because we're sinners. But because we're sinners, if we come to faith in Christ and we repent of our sins, we can be forgiven. There's no unforgiven sin in this, right? And many of you know or have personally experienced it, and it's very difficult. I mean, it's like experiencing a death in some ways. So it's not to say that obviously because we're sinners, there's situations that occur, and it is forgiving, but it is not God's standard. It is not God's design. It is not what God wants out of any marriage relationship, and that we need to trust God's design and process. But again, I said this last week, I'll say it again. Instead of always being reactive, we need to be proactive. And that means I know Troy, he's talking about, you know, looking back into things like true love waits and teaching on areas of purity. Now, he is a supplement. He is a walk beside you, but that ultimately has to happen in the home. We need to be teaching our children. We need them to understand God's design, and they need to learn this early on. Young men on the front row, young ladies, love you. I know you're paying attention. That's why I can do that. But God has a specific design and purpose. And it's not open to debate, and it's not open to alteration. When it does, it's because we have gone against God's design. John Piper says that if the most ultimate meaning of marriage is to represent the unbreakable covenant love between Christ and his church, we see that in Ephesians 5 that we read last week, then no human being has a right to break a marriage covenant. When the impossible day comes that Christ breaks his vow, I am with you always to the end of the age, then on that day, a human being may break his marriage covenant. This explains why Jesus does not settle for the divorce provision of Deuteronomy 24, but says, "What therefore God has joined together, let not man separate." In other words, since God is the one who decisively makes every marriage, only God has the right to break a marriage. And he does it by death, which is why the traditional and biblical marriage vows have one and only one limitation. You've said this if you've been married. What does it say? Till death do us part. But we don't understand the vows that we're making. We just kind of say them to get through. As long as we what? As long as we both shall live. Those are part of the marriage vows. C.S. Lewis says this. He says, there ought to be two different kinds of marriage. One governed by the state with rules enforced on all citizens. The other governed by the church with rules enforced by her church members. The distinction ought to be quite sharp so that a man knows which couples are married in a Christian sense and which are not. That's a good word, isn't it? Amen. That's a great reminder. Now, I would encourage you, point you to a couple of great resources out there. The Council on Biblical Manhood and Womanhood has got a great deal. Obviously, the Bible is our number one means by all stretch. But good resources, got great works up here. I don't know if any of you remember Dr. James Burkett. He pastored Carmel Baptist Church for probably 20 years, started the Christian radio station in Ashland, and literally broadcast all over the world. An incredible Bible teacher. But a lot of people don't realize he was also one of the most sought after speakers on family and areas of marriage. And he wrote a lot of these. He wrote a lot of little books. I think he led like 40 tours of Israel. He lived right there in the big white house across from Food Line that you see right there, him and Miss Carol. Incredible godly couple, incredible influence in my life, in my family's life. And he wrote a great little book called The New Testament Teaching on Marriage, Divorce, Remarriage, and the Family. And it gives a biblical perspective. And I only have one copy, so don't ask me for it. But I'll figure out because Lord took Dr. Burkett home a number of years ago. He was in his 90s. And when I was with him, he was in his late 70s. And you're talking about he took this young, goofy, you know, guy that needed a lot of guidance, and he poured into me. And but I'll figure out a way to make copies, because I don't think there's anything any way in here that we, you know, we can't do that to give you. But he was a brilliant mind. He had taken every word and like even words that aren't in Scripture, like abortion. The word abortion is not in Scripture, but he gave every single reference in Scripture to what the act of abortion is. So he would take any word like that. He did this whole thing for Nelson, which is a big publishing company. His Bible was like, you could barely see the actual words of the Bible in it. It was littered with his handwritten notes everywhere. Him and Miss Carol, I remember, were down in Charlotte, and Pastor Burke was probably 80 at this point. And literally, if you can believe it, someone literally came and mugged him and took the Bible. I mean, just devastating. But he's brilliant. Him and Miss Carol were actually introduced to each other by Billy Graham's mom. She was a nurse in the North Carolina area that they came out of. But he goes through here, and he has every single word, and he has every word in Greek. And he has the breakdown of every scripture, and I just say it's exceptional. And all I can say is, he breaks down what the exception clause is, and it ties into Deuteronomy 24. It's not the word for adultery. I know we use that. It's not. It's the word porneia. So you need to understand that. My point is, I'm not saying that there's not situations. And again, I can't emphasize this enough. I know the situations occur, but I'm saying, but to try to make God's word say things are permissible when God's word doesn't, you can't do that, and you need to know the entire text of the Bible. So I will get these somehow available so you can read them yourself. And then what I'm going to do to close with you today, any of you familiar with Zola Levitt? Zola Levitt is a Messianic Jew, for just a tremendous man of God. A little short book he wrote is a Christian love story, and he ties, because he was a devout Jew, and he came to faith in Christ, and he does this whole thing where he shows all the connections that any marriage ceremony has with God's word, and ultimately Christ in the church. So this is what I'm closing with today. So if you were to envision, and this still happens, we don't necessarily see it here, but if you were to go and witness a Hebrew wedding today, if you were to go to Israel, you will still see a lot of this played out. You will see it a lot of places throughout the Middle East, as well in a lot of parts of Africa. This is what you would still see. So a first century marriage always had this contract, or it was called a bridal price. I understood this weekend that Bill Carter, Ricky Johnson, is still waiting for, like, I think it was a herd of cattle for Candace's hand in marriage. Ricky, have you received anything? I mean, I don't know. I'm thinking that it's time's up, right? 20-some years, whatever you're holding out on. But it was a big, big deal. A price was to be paid for your bride. Why? Because your daughter was not, you know, your son was going to raise up, and he was going to kind of care for you. He was going to take care of the family. He was going to provide all those things. Your daughters, you married off. So they just didn't have that. They didn't have that financial value attached to them. So you wanted to make sure you married them off. But with that, you kind of got this bridal price paid, which was in essence to say, hey, you've done a good job raising your daughter. And so here is, and often it was farm animals, obviously. I mean, a lot of times it might have been a goat and two chickens. But I mean, a goat in that time was incredibly valuable. So there was a great value placed on this contract, this covenant that was to be made. And this is obviously tying into the fact that Christ paid the ultimate price for his church, the bride of Christ, who we are. So when a Jewish boy decided he wanted to get married, he would go over to this young lady's house with this contract of marriage that he and his father had made together. The father is always part of this process. And that bride price would be paid, and they would give it to the father. This proposal then would be sealed, if you would, over taking a cup of wine. We're going to celebrate the Lord's Supper today, where it's going to be signified of taking the remembrance of this cup. So in the course of the evening, after this contract was arranged, the suitor would pour a cup of wine, which was the act of a proposal. Now, this would be done in the presence of the suitor's family as well as that of the young lady. She would accept the proposal by picking up the cup and drinking it, or she could push the cup away and thus reject the proposal. We see this in 1 Corinthians, and it may be read today, but it says, "For I received from the Lord what I also deliver to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' And in the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat and drink the bread, the cup, eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" Now they were in what we call the betrothal period. Now, it's important to get this. We, as the church, we are in the betrothal period. That's where we still are. We have not been fully presented to Christ. That's what sanctification is. When you come to faith in Christ, we're to be set apart. That's what sanctified means, okay? So the act of sanctification is we've been set apart for Christ. We've been marked. That's why we publicly proclaim our faith. When we get baptized, we are putting that mark that says, "I am his. I am committed my life to Christ." That is our verbal proclamation, our public proclamation. But we are in that betrothal period. When Christ returns, or we go home first, we will then be presented. But ultimately, the church is presented to Christ as the bride of Christ. So here, this soon-to-be bride, she is now betrothed. Okay? She, if she obviously, hopefully, responds, drinks the cup, then the young man will say something like, "Well, now I go and prepare a place for you." Now, what he's going to do is he's going to return with his father to his father's house. And there at his father's house, he's going to build what would be considered a bridal chamber. He is going to prepare a place for his future bride. It is there that the two will become one in flesh. They will come and consummate the marriage, and they will become husband and wife. Now, it's important because when this young man went back with his father to his father's house to prepare a place for his future bride, he did not get to say when it would be complete. He had to work, and as he worked on this this part of the house, if his father said, "Nope, that's not good enough, you need to redo that part, you need to redo this," and until the father said, "You may go get your bride," he was not allowed to. He could rush through it, but then the father could say, "Well, you got to start over again because you didn't do a good job." Only the father. Scripture is very clear on this, right? Jesus even said in John 14, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may also be." I want you to see that this entire picture of a marriage is God's design, and it is to point to the gospel. So now this young lady, she has been betrothed. This young man has gone to prepare a place. Meanwhile, this young lady is to keep herself pure. She is to keep herself consecrated. She is set apart. She is no longer her own because there is now a covenant in place. So if she were to go out during the day, she would wear a veil. This would have been a signification to all those in the community that she has been spoken for. She has been set apart. And she would wear this veil to indicate she was betrothed. 1 Corinthians 6:19, "Or do you not know that your body is a temple, the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God? You are not your own, for you were bought with a price, so glorify God in your body." She had been purchased, okay? This was a good thing, purchased, because it meant that there was a price, there was a heavy price to have this beautiful young lady as your future bride. So, she would not know. She had to always be prepared. Under the betrothal contract, the fiancé, this young man, could come back and claim his bride at any time without notice. And the bride would come usually with the father as well as his best man. So when this bridal chamber was finished and this young man was told by his father, "You can now go get your bride," he would go, and often it would be at night, but it could be at any point in time. We know from Matthew 24:36, it says, "But concerning that day and hour when Christ will return, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father." Do you see the correlation? Do you see the picture that God gives us? It's such a beautiful picture, and why we need to understand this to truly understand marriage. Typically, the bridegroom would come to pick up his new bride at night, quite often around midnight, because no one knew what date this would be. The prospective bride would sit in joyful anticipation by her window night after night, perhaps for months. In some cases, she would not see her betrothed future husband at any time between the proposal and the ultimate marriage night. When the father's groom would finally announce that the bridal chamber was ready, he said, "Go and get your brothers and your groomsmen and go get your bride." That night, the groom and his friends would sneak over to the bride's house around midnight to surprise her. And then this is played out in Matthew 25, the parable of the 10 virgins. It says, "Then the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. Five of them were foolish and five were wise. But when the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them. But the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. And as the bridegroom was delayed, they all became drowsy and slept. But at midnight, there was a cry, 'Here is the bridegroom, come out to meet him.'" So we are to be always prepared. We do not know the day, the moment, the time. Someone said to me this week, they said, "Hey, you know, we're in the end times." Yeah, it started in Acts 2. Started 2,000 years ago. We are in the end times. And Jesus can come back any moment. But don't forsake and think that, hey, are we closer today than yesterday? Absolutely. We're closer now than we'll be in 10 minutes? Absolutely. And he can come at any moment, any time, and we need to be prepared. But we've been in the end times, folks, for 2,000 years. And guess what, though? He's coming. We need to have our lampstands lit. We need to be prepared for his coming. So then the groom's arrival was announced with a shout. They would normally use the shofar. The shofar they would bring out, they would sound the shofar because, you know what, your soon-to-be bride, she's got curling irons in, she hasn't made up her face, she's not ready. So that would give her 30 seconds notice. No, it would give her a little bit of notice so she could kind of get prepared because she's about to be whisked away to her wedding night. So the groom's arrival was that. The groom would get close to the house, and then they would have this great shout, and then the shofar would be sounded. And we know that, right? And the shofar would be sounded, and Christ returned. So the wedding party would bring their lamps out for the trip. When the groom's party arrived, they would rush in. Take any of the girls with their lamps, or sisters, or bridesmaids, obviously making sure they took the one that is to be the one with the veil on. That'd be awkward, right? "Wait a minute, this isn't the one. You remember Leah and Rachel? It can happen. It's happened before. It happened again," right? Again, follow that story through, and this comes around and starts adding up even more. The bride would then be taken off with her new husband for the wedding night, and then they would go to this bridal chamber. The wedding, that would mean, and then the marriage would be consummated, and then after that would be this great celebration. So on the wedding night, the best man would wait outside the wedding chamber for the signal from the groom. And then once the marriage was consummated, they would announce to all the guests. All the guests had arrived. Guess what? You know who had the guest list? The Father. The Father's the one who not only has it, he made it. The Father makes the guest list. The Father has invited those. Guess what the Father does today? The Father draws us by the Spirit to the Son, and the Father has the guest list, and the Father knows who's in and who's not going to be in. So in this custom, after the wedding was consummated, the husband would come out with his new bride, and then the wedding reception, which we know as this wedding banquet. And then I'm going to read to you as I close this. This is the marriage supper of the Lamb that we see in Scripture in Revelation 19. Starting in verse 6, "Then I heard what seemed to be the voice of a great multitude, like the roar of many waters, and like the sound of almighty peals of thunder, crying out, 'Hallelujah, for the Lord our God, the Almighty, reigns. Let us rejoice and exult and give him the glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. It was granted her to clothe herself with fine linen, bright and pure, for the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints.' And the angel said to me, 'Write this, blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb.' And he said to me, these are the true words of God. Then I fell down at his feet to worship him. But he said to me, you must not do that. I am a fellow servant with you and your brothers who hold to the testimony of Jesus. That's why we don't worship angels. Okay? For the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. Then I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse. The one sitting on it is called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes are like a flame of fire, and on his head are many diadems. And he has a name written that no one knows but himself. He is clothed in a robe dipped in blood, and the name by which he is called is the Word of God. And the armies of heaven, arrayed in fine linen, white and pure, were following him on white horses. From his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations, and he will rule them with a rod of iron. He will tread the winepress of the wrath of God the Almighty. On his robe and on his thigh he has a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Father, we just are so thankful that God, for all those who place their faith and trust in Christ alone, that God, we have been invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. That, Father, there will be a day and a time in the not-so-distant future, although we don't know exactly when, but we need to be ready, we need to be prepared at all times, in which you will return, that you will send your Son, Jesus Christ, and he will come and he will call all those to himself. He will call those whom he has purchased, that purchase that came with the uttermost cost, the very blood of Jesus. So, Father, I pray this morning that for any man, woman, and child in this room, that Father, they have not heeded that invitation, that God, by your Spirit, you are drawing that person, that today they would, by faith, trust in Jesus Christ alone. That, Father, that they can know salvation has come. And that, Father, at that moment, God, you seal them with the very Spirit of God, and that they are sealed until the day of redemption, until we will stand with our King, our Lord of Lords, and our King of Kings. So, Father, I just pray that as we get ready to take and celebrate this time of communion, that, Father, you are preparing our hearts, that this is for all those who have been invited and who have received the invitation. They have received Jesus Christ by faith alone, that this is our time to have this foreshadowing of what is to come when we will gather with all those brothers and sisters in Christ from every corner of the globe, from every time in history that have trusted in Jesus Christ, and we will celebrate the marriage supper of the Lamb. So, Father, we are so grateful that, God, you have given us this incredible picture of marriage to be an example for those to see the picture of the gospel. And, Father, but because of sin and because of our own sinfulness, we know we mar it. And God, in even cases where there has been divorce and other areas, Father, we just pray that, God, all that is forgiven under the blood of Christ. But may we live victoriously in Christ, but teach others the beauty of marriage, that we don't want anyone to experience that. And if we would just simply do more on the front side, there's just so much less heartache we will experience on the back. So, Father, may we raise up a generation of young people who will not know the things of divorce, but they will commit themselves to holy matrimony, designed by you, Father, and committed by you, and to draw us to yourself through this process, as it is a great part of sanctification. So, Father, you are so good and so gracious to us, and, Father, we deserve none of it. But, Father, we are grateful, and we pray that you would do all things through your Son, Jesus' name, in whose name we pray. Amen.